Our next interview is with Tom Goldwasser. Tom is a bookseller from the San Francisco Bay Area, etc. And Tom, talk a little bit about your background, your family, schools you went to, siblings, etc. Take us up through your life, up through probably through high school.
Begin
anywhere.
I grew up in Chicago as the oldest of three children, and my father is a professor of biochemistry at the University of Chicago, and my mother worked from time to time in the, well, after the children were grown, my mother worked in administration at the university. I went to school, the university's school, laboratory schools for grade school and high school.
In the Chicago area?
Yes, in the south side of Chicago.
When did your family move, or did they not move? When did you venture your way out to California?
I came to California in San Francisco the week I graduated from high school, and have scarcely ever returned for more than a week to the Midwest.
Are your parents still alive?
My father's still alive.
Does he still live out in the Midwest?
Yeah, he still lives in the same neighborhood where he's been for the last, since the 1940s.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so here you are. You're just graduated high school, and you're out in California.
Mm-hmm. Now
what happens?
Around for a few years, a little, pursuing or not pursuing various pastimes. And eventually I did settle in San Francisco in around 72 or 73, I guess.
So now you're in San Francisco, it's 1972.
72 was it? Something like that.
Okay.
Or 73, married with one child, I think. Hard to remember the dates. Needed a job, I walked into a used bookstore.
Which one?
Holmes Books.
Was that
Third
the Holmes
Market?
On Market?
San Francisco on 3rd Street.
Yeah, I remember.
In fact, had I a street view now, I could, from my office, I could look into that storefront.
Mm. How long were you at Holmes?
About maybe two years or something like that.
What?
Year
what?
And a half, 2 years. I was running started my own business concurrently while I was there, realizing, as a scouting.
And what got you interested in books to begin with?
Well, I've always been interested in books. Even as a small child, I was always interested in books. I enjoyed being surrounded by books and spent my time in libraries and
scouting as well.
Used bookstores of the neighborhood.
So here you are, now you've worked for Holmes for 2 years. Now what do you do?
Briefly. I had begun to spend my afternoons or lunch hours or weekends going around to the, there was quite a thriving
it certainly was.
Market for many booksellers around downtown San Francisco, used and rare. And I would spend some of my time going into these places and looking around and talking to the people, the owners. I found everyone was quite engaging, friendly, happy to share. Most of them were quite happy to share their knowledge and were not off-put by whatever I was doing. I was interested. I learned it was easy to buy a book here and sell it there.
Yeah. When did you start working at Serendipity?
I started working there, I think, about 1975. I'd been on my own, issued a catalog. I'd gotten to know various collectors, librarians in the area, and I'd issued a catalog and it accumulated some stock for another one. And then Peter Howard asked me if I would come and work for Serendipity. I agreed to do that.
Did you have a relationship with him before you went to work?
I had met him a few times. I think I'd probably sold him a few. I'd sold him a few pieces, and I'd bought some things in the shop. I didn't know him well.
How long did you work at Serendipity?
About 15 years.
Talk a little bit about your experience there, those 15 years. How would you characterize it?
I'm not sure how I would characterize it. There were a lot of things. It was a period of a lot of change in the market, in the book market. I mean, that store specialized in modern first editions.
Right.
And particularly in contemporary and slightly pre-contemporary poetry and fiction. There had been a greater emphasis on new publications before I started working there, and I was interested in a lot of different things, and I had already contacts with people who were collectors of fine printing and printers and book arts, which was not an area that that firm had really had done much in. But I liked that, and I did more of that, and I enjoyed learning different genres of within the literary field, and those were the books that were easiest to scout because they were everywhere.
Yeah.
In those days, prices were different from one place to another, and people who wanted first editions didn't know that you could still buy the book remaindered for a dollar. They'd be happy to pay 35 because you told them. It was interesting to meet more people, to attend the book fairs, which I hadn't been to.
Yeah.
The first book fair I went to was at the Fairmont Hotel in San Francisco. It was the last one that was there. We bought at that fair one of the great, great rarities of 20th century poetry. That was quite exciting. So all the fairs seemed to have something exciting happening at them.
In
those days, some great discovery would appear, or there was buzz. A book would appear and then change hands five times. Remember
those stories were always fun.
Yeah.
So you're at Serendipity now for 15 years. Why did you decide to go to work for someone else when you had obviously started to be on your own?
Well, I didn't have any money or time. I had two children. That was more or less the reason. Now, why I stayed that long may be different.
How old are your children now?
Inertia. They're in their 30s.
Okay. Do either of your children have any interest in the business?
None of them have any real particular interest in.
Yeah.
At least not yet. I haven't failed with enough other things.
Well, okay, here you are. You're at Serendipity, and you've been here for 15 years, and now you strike out on your own. So what do you do? How do you do it?
I had some things some collections that I had of my own that I sold. I continued buying and selling books. I knew people. I put out a catalog. I called people up. Go to the auction, keep your hand up till you get tired, and buy something.
Mm.
And then try to turn around and sell it for more, or go to the wherever the sources are, private, public, issue a catalog, write to people and hope that they're interested in what you think they'll be interested in.
Okay.
So we're still doing the same thing.
So what was the year? Do you remember the year that you left Serendipity and began on your own?
That when my second catalog one was issued in 1990.
Okay.
So now I've been, it's been, that's now what, 20 years.
It's a It's been a while. What are some of your recollections about the early days of the trade? Who are some of the people that stand out in your mind? Who are some of the people that you consider to be somewhat like mentors, or someone that you would look up to as a person who knew what they were doing, etc.?
Well, the in San Francisco, the dealers who I knew best and who were always the most welcoming and sharing their knowledge and were, you know, happy to sell you something that you wanted at a good price were Franklin Gillam, Barney Rosenthal, and David McGee.
David McGee is one of my personal favorites.
Yeah. You know, Warren Howells was a great, great shop. He was not quite as open as other people, you know.
Did you continue?
But I did, I spent, I, you know, he was certainly full of interesting knowledge.
Oh, yeah. So these are principally the people who you remember from your early days in the trade. There's a lot of things that have happened in the last 20
years. John Scapazzi was a good bookseller there.
Yeah. And what was the name of the fellow in Oakland? Everett Cunningham.
Everett Cunningham.
Was a character.
Everett Cunningham was a character. I never really respected his inventory.
Well,
but he had a good Joyce collection, which was sold after he died, and I bought most of it.
I understand he donated a building that he had owned to the ABAA.
Is that right?
Yeah, and I don't know what it sold for, but he willed it to the ABAA on his death, which I thought was kind of interesting. But
yeah.
Anyway, let's talk a little bit about the internet, Tom. Did you have an easy transition? Are you a computer guy, or was it a difficult situation for you?
Well, I always thought that having everything having electronic databases was a great way to manage your inventory. You know, the early days of the internet, the speeds were so slow that it was, as you remember, it wasn't all that useful. When you get high speed, then it became much more useful. It makes a great sea of material available.
What percentage of your business comes from your shop, from your catalog, from book fairs, from the internet? Is there any way you can divide it up in your mind?
Well, it varies from year to year.
Just in general.
In general, probably 50% of the business is from, at least 50% is from direct offers to
the clientele.
Yeah. Probably 20-25% is internet, and then book fairs. Book fairs might be 20% in a year. You know, catalogs, because I only do one a year, it's probably 20, might be 15-20% or something like that. It probably adds up to more than 100, but.
Just from a general statistic point of view, I like to ask the question because it varies from bookseller to bookseller.
Yeah.
And maybe 25 years from now, people are going to look at us and say, what a bunch of bozos.
They already
they had
say
to,
that.
Had to do it this way.
Yeah, and they can't add.
And they can't subtract either.
Yeah.
Another question would be, if you were entering the book trade right now, today, could you or would you?
Now isn't very. It's very difficult to do it. If you're very well capitalized, you can do it, and you know, say it's a way to lose money very slowly.
In easy doses, huh?
Yeah. It's difficult now. It's a kind of a. I think it's a. If you really care about looking for material and preserving it and presenting it, then and by material I mean printed and manuscript. Records of culture, then it's a good thing to do. And if you have a commercial bent in that, then it would be something to do. I don't know how I would feel if I were 21 again. Would I do it? I'd probably not.
Right.
But I don't know. I mean, I would have grown up differently.
That's right. What do you see as some of the great challenges that face us as an antiquarian trade as we move forward in the next 10 or 20 years?
I think identifying what will be of value to the future, what is worth preserving, I mean, as a trade in a more focused way, we could say that the difficulty for the independent dealer in getting material that's very hotly competed for by all auction houses and by other. Let's say better capitalized or more aggressive dealers. For the large number of people who are looking for particular niches, that are at a middle level or below a middle level of the trade hierarchy, it becomes more difficult. That things are not selling readily, that the wide availability of everything makes collecting less fun. People, there's less pursuit, so that collecting books particularly is, I think, a declining recreation in the competition for people's entertainment attention.
How do you respond to those who say that the antiquarian book business will be dead in 25 years?
I haven't heard anyone say that.
Okay, well, I just did.
No. I think 25 years is probably... No, I don't think that the antiquarian book business will be dead, but it may be considerably reduced in size.
And different.
And the business expanded a lot in the 80s, and the 80s and maybe in the early 90s. In the 90s particularly, I guess it was. There was a lot of capital from new collectors and libraries that went into the market in the 80s and the beginning of the 90s. It was, and people seemed to, things like things would sell. And now that's... the economies have changed, the style of consumption has changed. So it'll be more difficult, I expect. I don't think it'll disappear. I mean, there's still things to buy and sell that people want.
Yeah. The manuscript dealers tell me that there'll always be a business in documents and manuscripts.
I expect so. I mean, the printed books, where it's a fair, where things are, that people are no longer looking for them as texts, and there are those who enjoy having the physical form, but the idea of the antiquarian book as a valuable research object for anything other than its own history, that is the copy's history or the printing history, as a text, that market will probably disappear largely.
Yeah, it's a shame. They'll go the way of reference books.
Well, right.
Just disappear.
Well, the information's not disappearing. So
no.
It's just it's in a more convenient form than
much more.
You would adapt to that. Can't sell things people don't need.
It's true. What percentage of your business is collectors, libraries, dealers? Can you categorize it some way?
Again, it vary. It'll vary from year to year, and but over the probably 50% collectors, and 25% libraries, and 25% dealers. If I was going to divide it like that. In some years, one will be higher than the other.
Yeah, but just in general.
In general, it's probably like that. Although those numbers may be a little old.
What do you see as some of the great challenges facing our trade as we move forward 10 or 15 or 20 years into the future?
I think paying attention to what the world is interested in, finding out what will the collectors and the institutions care about. We need to continue to study that. Where is the material that we're going to sell going to come from, right? Where are the sources? If you're selling 18th century American material, are there more sources, or are you going to keep recycling the same things that have been within the trade or within collectors' hands for? There may be still enough of that, but in certain areas of collecting disappear because there's not enough material.
Do you find that having a shop is your best way of doing business?
Well, I don't have a shop anymore. I haven't had a shop for a couple of years now.
Oh, so are you by appointment only?
No, I have an office, but it doesn't doesn't really generate. I just always had I thought of myself as having a place of business in downtown.
Almost. Thank you. Please continue.
Having a shop or an office in the heart of the city is probably more to do with how I see myself than any other practical matter. Although, when I had the shop, people would come in, but
yeah,
and the office people come in. But I'm not sure it's often enough to really make that much of a difference. If they were people I knew, I could go and meet. I could have them come anywhere. It was close enough.
But. Is all your inventory in your office?
Mostly. Some of it's scattered with other people might have it.
Yeah. Do you prescribe to the theory of a lot of booksellers that working together in partnerships? How do you see that?
I think that gives everyone a chance to spread your risk and more widely to have a larger share of the market if you are aggressive enough to do that, buy all the material. It also gives you the opportunity because different customers will respond to different persons or different styles.
True.
So,
well, just to close things out, if there was one thing that you would suggest to a young person, if they came to you and said, Mr. Goldwasser, I'm thinking about becoming a bookseller, what's your advice? What would you say?
I'd be tempted to quote somebody else, but that if you're interested in that, you need to study their material very well. Well, know the people who are interested in what you're interested in. Pay attention to business principles. If you want to run a business, you have a lot of people don't really understand how a business works, and if you want to have a business, you have to understand that. Continue educating yourself.
One person, when I asked that question, said, "Own your own building."
Oh yeah,
that was a pretty good advice.
Yeah, marry the child of a major collector.
That's also good advice. Okay, we've come to the end of our session,
and I can't. I couldn't think of anything. I think I've been lucky to be in this business.
I think a lot of us feel that way. It's been a great, great trip, et cetera. Well, something? Our 30 minutes are up. And I told you it was going to be painless.
Well, I didn't mention Greg Gibson.
You do. You've got a minute.
Okay.
Talk a little bit about Greg, who we all know and love.
He was a friend of mine. I met him on my first trip when I was just gathering books. He was barely in books. I've known him for longer than I think I've been in the business. We were there. We've been friends for 30 years, and wasn't so much a mentor as somebody I've come along with as we've come along in this experience. He became a specialist by what he was, and I've remained a generalist. But over the years, we've done so many road trips. And then I have to mention Lynn Respas, who I've partnered up with, and we've bought and sold books, and he's been, you know, the thing in this business is when you're dealing with straight people, you never have to question it, and you don't have to watch your back, and you...
That's true.
And it's such a luxury.
It's a great business, isn't it?
It is a great business.
Thanks a lot, John. Appreciate
Thank
it.
Thank you, Mike.
Our next interview is with Tom Goldwasser. Tom is a bookseller from the San Francisco Bay Area, etc. And Tom, talk a little bit about your background, your family, schools you went to, siblings, etc. Take us up through your life, up through probably through high school.
Begin
anywhere.
I grew up in Chicago as the oldest of three children, and my father is a professor of biochemistry at the University of Chicago, and my mother worked from time to time in the, well, after the children were grown, my mother worked in administration at the university. I went to school, the university's school, laboratory schools for grade school and high school.
In the Chicago area?
Yes, in the south side of Chicago.
When did your family move, or did they not move? When did you venture your way out to California?
I came to California in San Francisco the week I graduated from high school, and have scarcely ever returned for more than a week to the Midwest.
Are your parents still alive?
My father's still alive.
Does he still live out in the Midwest?
Yeah, he still lives in the same neighborhood where he's been for the last... since the 1940s.
Yeah. Okay, so here you are. You're just graduated high school, and you're out in California.
Mm-hmm. Now
traveled
around for a few years, a little, pursuing or not pursuing various pastimes, and eventually I did settle in San Francisco in around 72 or 73, I guess.
And okay, so now you're in San Francisco. It's
1972. 72, was it? Something like that.
Okay.
Or 73. Married with one child, I think. Hard to remember the dates. Needed a job. I walked into a used bookstore.
Which one?
Holmes Books.
Was that
Third
the Holmes
Market?
On Market.
San Francisco on Third Street.
Yeah, I remember.
In fact. Had I a street view now, I could, from my office, I could look into that storefront.
Mm. How long were you at Holmes?
About maybe two years or something like that.
What,
year
what?
And a half, 2 years. I was running started my own business concurrently while I was there, realizing, as a scouting.
And what got you interested in books to begin with?
Well, I've always been.
Okay, so even as a young man?
Even as a small child, I was always interested in books. I enjoyed being surrounded by books and spent my time in libraries. Used bookstores of the neighborhood. And
so here you are. Now you've worked for Holmes for 2 years. Now what do you do?
Briefly. I had begun to spend my afternoons or lunch hours or weekends going around to it was quite a thriving
it certainly was
market for many booksellers around downtown San Francisco, used and rare, and I would spend some of my time going into these places and looking around and talking to the people, the owners. Found everyone was quite engaging, friendly, you know, happy to share. Most of them were quite happy to share their knowledge and were not off-put by whatever I was doing. I was interested. I learned it was easy to buy a book here and sell it there.
Yeah. When did you start working at Serendipity?
I started working there, I think, about 1975. I'd been on my own, issued a catalog. I've gotten to know various collectors, librarians in the area. And I'd issued a catalog, and it accumulated some stock for another one. And then Peter Howard asked me if I would come and work for Serendipity. Agreed to do that.
Did you have a relationship with him before you went to work?
I had met him a few times. I think I'd probably sold him a few. I'd sold him a few pieces, and I'd bought some things in the shop. I didn't know him well.
How long did you work at Serendipity?
About 15 years.
Talk a little bit about your experience there, those 15 years. How would you characterize it?
I'm not sure how I would characterize it. There were a lot of things. It was a period of a lot of change in the market, in the book market. I mean, that store specialized in modern first editions.
Right.
And particularly in contemporary and slightly pre-contemporary poetry and fiction. There had been a greater emphasis on new publications before I started working there, and I was interested in a lot of different things, and I had already contacts with people who were collectors of fine printing and printers and book arts, which was not an area that that firm had really had done much in, but I liked that, and I did more of that, and I enjoyed learning different genres of within the literary field, and those were the books that were easiest to scout because they were everywhere.
Yeah.
In those days, prices were different from one place to another, and people who wanted first editions didn't know that you could still buy the book remaindered for a dollar. They'd be happy to pay $35 because you told them. It was interesting to meet more people, to attend the book fairs, which I hadn't been to.
Yeah.
The first book fair I went to was at the Fairmont Hotel in San Francisco. That was the last one that was there. We bought at that fair one of the great, great rarities of 20th century poetry. That was quite exciting. So all the fairs seemed to have something exciting happening at them.
In those days,
some great discovery would appear, or there was buzz. A book would appear and then change hands five times.
I
remember
those stories were always fun.
Yeah.
So you're at Serendipity now for 15 years. Why did you decide to go to work for someone else when you had obviously started to be on your own?
Well, I didn't have any money or time. I had two children. That was more or less the reason. Now, why I stayed that long may be different.
How old are your children now?
Inertia. They're in their 30s.
Okay. Do either of your children have any interest in the business?
None of them have any real particular interest in.
Yeah.
At least not yet. I haven't failed with enough other things.
Well, okay. Here you are. You're at Serendipity, and you've been here for 15 years, and now you strike out on your own. So what do you do? How do you do it?
I had some things some collections that I had of my own that I sold. I continued buying and selling books. I knew people. I put out a catalog. I called people up. go to the auction, keep your hand up till you get tired and buy something, and then try to turn around and sell it for more, or go to the wherever the sources are, private, public, issue a catalog, write to people and hope that they're interested in what you think they'll be interested in.
Okay,
so we're still doing the same thing.
So what was the year, do you remember the year that you left Serendipity and began on your own?
That when my second catalog one was issued in 1990.
Okay.
So now that's now what, 20 years?
It's been a while. Well, what are some of your recollections about the early days of the trade? Who are some of the people that stand out in your mind? Who are some of the people that you consider to be somewhat like mentors, or someone that you would look up to as a person who knew what they were doing, etc.?
Well, in San Francisco, the dealers who I knew best and who were always the most welcoming and sharing their knowledge and were happy to sell you something that you wanted at a good price were Franklin Gillam, Barney Rosenthal, and David McGee.
David McGee is one of my personal favorites.
Yeah. Warren Howells was a great, great shop. He was not quite as open as other people.
Did you continue?
But I did. He was certainly full of interesting knowledge.
Oh, yeah. So these are principally the people who you remember from your early days in the trade. There's a lot of things that have happened in the last
John Scapazzi
20 years.
John Scapazzi was a good bookseller there. Yeah.
And what was the name of the fellow in Oakland? Everett Cunningham.
Everett Cunningham.
Was a character.
Everett Cunningham was a character. I never really respected his inventory.
Well,
but he had a good Joyce collection, which was sold after he died, and I bought most of it.
I understand he donated a building that he had owned to the ABAA.
Is that right?
Yeah, and I don't know what it sold for, but he willed it to the ABAA on his death, which I thought was kind of interesting. But anyway, let's talk a little bit about the internet, Tom. Did you have an easy transition? Are you a computer guy, or was it a difficult situation for you?
Well, I always thought that having everything having electronic databases was a great way to manage your inventory. The early days of the internet, the speeds were so slow that it was, as you remember, it wasn't all that useful. When you get high speed, then it became much more useful. It makes this great sea of material available.
What percentage of your business comes from your shop, from your catalog, from book fairs, from the internet? Is there any way you can divide it up in your mind?
Well, it varies from year to year.
Just in general.
In general, probably 50% of the business is from, at least 50% is from direct offers to
the clientele.
Yeah. Probably 20-25% is internet, and then book fairs. Book fairs might be 20% in a year. Catalogs, because I only do one a year, it's probably 20, might be 15-20% or something like that. It probably adds up to more than 100, but.
Just from a general statistic point of view, I like to ask the question because it varies from bookseller to bookseller.
Yeah.
And maybe 25 years from now, people are going to look at us and say, what a bunch of bozos.
They already
had to,
say
they had
that.
To do it this way.
Yeah, and they can't add.
And they can't subtract either.
Yeah.
Another question would be, if you were entering the book trade right now, today, could you or would you?
Now it's very difficult to do it. If you're very well capitalized, you can do it, and then, say it's a way to lose money very slowly.
In easy doses, huh?
Yeah. It's difficult now. It's a kind of a, I think it's a, if you really care about looking for material and preserving it and presenting it, then and by material I mean printed and manuscript records of culture, then it's a good thing to do. And if you have a commercial bent in that, then it would be something to do. I don't know how I would feel if I were 21 again. Would I do it? I'd probably not. But I don't know. I mean, I would have grown up differently.
That's right. What do you see as some of the great challenges that face us as an antiquarian trade as we move forward in the next 10 or 20 years?
I think identifying what will be of value to the future, what is worth preserving. I mean, as a trade in a more focused way, we could say that the difficulty for the independent dealer in getting material that's very hotly competed for by auction houses and by other let's say better capitalized or more aggressive dealers. For the large number of people who are looking for particular niches, that are at a middle or a middle level or below a middle level of the trade hierarchy, it becomes more difficult. That things are not selling readily, that the wide availability of everything makes collecting less fun. People, there's less pursuit, so that collecting books particularly is, I think, a declining recreation in the competition for people's entertainment attention.
How do you respond to those who say that the antiquarian book business will be dead in 25 years?
I haven't heard anyone say that.
Okay, well, I just did.
No. I think 25 years is probably... No, I don't think that the antiquarian book business will be dead, but it may be considerably reduced in size.
And different.
And the business expanded a lot in the 80s. And the 80s and maybe in the early 90s. In the 90s particularly, I guess it was. There was a lot of capital from new collectors and libraries that went into the market in the 80s and the beginning of the 90s. It was, and people seemed to, things like there were things would sell. And now that's... the economies have changed, the style of consumption has changed. So it'll be more difficult, I expect. I don't think it'll disappear. I mean, there's still things to buy and sell that people want.
Yeah. The manuscript dealers tell me that there'll always be a business in documents and manuscripts.
I expect so. I mean, the printed books, where it's a fair, where things are, that people are no longer looking for them as texts, and there are those who enjoy having the physical form, but the idea of the antiquarian book as a valuable research object for anything other than its own history, that is the copy's history or the printing history, as a text, that market will probably disappear largely.
Yeah, it's a shame. They'll go the way of reference books.
Well, right. That's
just disappear.
The information's not disappearing. So
no.
It's just it's in a more convenient form than
much more.
You would adapt to that. Can't sell things people don't need.
It's true. What percentage of your business is collectors, libraries, dealers. Can you categorize it some way?
Again, it'll vary from year to year, but over the probably 50% collectors and 25% libraries and 25% dealers. If I was going to divide it like that, in some years one will be higher than the other.
Yeah, but just in general.
In general, it's probably like that. Although those numbers may be a little old.
What do you see as some of the great challenges facing our trade as we move forward 10 or 15 or 20 years into the future?
I think paying attention to what the world is interested in, finding out what will the collectors and the institutions care about. We need to continue to study that. Where is the material that we're going to sell going to come from, right? Where are the sources? If you're selling 18th century American material, are there more sources, or are you going to keep recycling the same things that have been within the trade or within collectors' hands for? There may be still enough of that, but in certain areas certain areas of collecting disappear because there's not enough material.
Do you find that having a shop is your best way of doing business?
Well, I don't have a shop anymore. I've been in a shop for a couple of years now.
Oh, so are you by appointment only?
No, I have an office, but it doesn't doesn't really generate. I just always had I thought of myself as having a place of business in downtown.
Almost. Thank you. Please continue.
Having a shop or an office in the heart of the city is probably more to do with how I see myself than any other practical matter. Although, when I had the shop, people would come in, but and the office people come in. But I'm not sure it's often enough to really make that much of a difference. If they were people I knew, I could go and meet. I could have them come anywhere. It was close enough.
But. Is all your inventory in your office?
Mostly. Some of it's scattered with other people might have it.
Yeah. Do you prescribe to the theory of a lot of booksellers that working together in partnerships? How do you see that?
I think that gives everyone a chance to spread your risk and more widely to have a larger share of the market if you are aggressive enough to do that, buy all the material. It also gives you the opportunity because different customers will respond to different persons or different styles.
True.
So,
well, just to close things out, if there was one thing that you would suggest to a young person, if they came to you and said, "Mr. Goldwasser, I'm thinking about becoming a bookseller, what's your advice?" What would you say?
I'd be tempted to quote somebody else, but that if you're interested in that, you need to study their material very well. Know the people who are interested in what you're interested in. Pay attention to business principles. If you want to run a business, you have a lot of people don't really understand how a business works, and if you want to have a business, you have to understand that. Continue educating yourself.
One person, when I asked that question, said, "Own your own building."
Oh yeah,
I thought that was a pretty good advice.
Yeah, marry the child of a major collector.
That's also good advice. Okay, we've come to the end of our session.